Diane, I'm listening to a podcast, Black Lodge Trivia Night. I've never heard so many game aspirations in my life.
Art got to the threshold where it's like, okay, I didn't have a lot of time to prep tonight, so I'm gonna let the bullshit talk happen for a little bit. And then we crossed it, so he's like, I'm gonna start recording now.
I can't take that anymore.
Yeah, right.
There will be no more fucking fun. Like, yeah. we're into this shit now.
I needed 12 minutes of dead air time, and you guys talked for 42 fucking minutes.
I didn't need it that much. Yeah. I guess, should we start, since I'm about to talk about the actual bullshit? Oh,
we started a while ago. Like, yeah. You're good.
All right.
Should we hit record now that we're going to talk politics?
right. TMJ. Welcome to Black Lodge Trivia Night. I am Art. I'm here with Matt and Patrick. How you guys doing tonight?
Peachy keen, brother.
Fantastic. Yeah. We are back doing our Mythras Imperative Cold War spy game, The Circus. I think this is our fourth session. And I'm really excited to see where this goes.
We left it on a little cliffhanger.
Yeah, we managed to. It's sort of like a weird rom-com meet cute. You got the prostitute whose accent broke into the backseat with your target, who you're supposed to compromise, Albie.
And, you ever see Mr. and Mrs. Smith, either version of it?
I've not seen
the new one. I want to see the Donald Glover one, but I haven't seen it yet. But it's kind of like that, like, oh, ha 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 ha, and then now shit's hitting the fan. It's time to spy.
That's right. But before we do that, I did have one trivia question.
Of course.
Season one, episode one, the pilot. How many characters have their names misspelled in the credits?
Oh, shit. Why did I even know they did? Well, it must be like a weird number, more than one.
I'll say this. I wasn't able to verify it to see if they fixed it in like future releases. But this is something I found apparently in the original.
I'll say four.
I was just thinking four. That feels right.
All right. The correct answer is two.
Oh. Damn.
And would you like to take a guess randomly of who those two might be?
Audrey?
Laura Palmer.
Is Audrey one of them?
No.
Hmm.
It's David Lynch. No.
Josie? 90s little casual racism.
Ooh. I'll let you, when you guys are ready with your final answer, let me know.
Oh, okay. Josie and Catherine. I don't know.
Okay.
Sounds good to me.
Catherine is one of them.
Ooh,
apparently her name, let's see, Catherine Martell, they spelled the first name with a K in the pilot's credits. And the second person was Lucy.
Ah, okay.
Her name, in theory, in the pilot was Lucy Morgan, when in reality, her name is Lucy Moran.
Ah.
So they stuck a G in there. So again, I wasn't able to double check. I was actually intending to watch like the opening and closing credits of the pilot today, but life was too crazy. So I don't know if they ever fixed it, but apparently that was the case in the original airing.
And you know, we're not going to fact check it. So like you could completely be
must
just
be true.
On smoke ass our up.
Smoke ass.
You could be blowing smoke up our asses and we would never check this. Although when I rewatch the pilot, I will.
Absolutely. We should make smoke acid up a thing.
It's another t-shirt right
let's
there.
Make that happen. Yeah.
Black Lodge Trivia, smoke that ass up.
It's a car burning rubber outside of a lobby.
In the lobby.
And the tread marks, the skid marks spell out blow up whatever I said.
Blow ass up that smoke.
Yeah, blow ass up your smoke.
Is that what it is?
All smoke
right.
Ass.
Burn up dust. Your... Eat my rubber. Name that movie.
Okay, so there we go. We got our trivia out of the way.
Christmas Vacation.
What was that?
Nothing. Proceed.
I will not abide. No. Getting off topic like that.
We are
professionals. We're professionals.
We're serious podcasters.
We're very serious podcasters. What are you drinking tonight?
Because podcasting is a series. So, so there we were. We had drove the car out of the lobby with both, let's see, we got Veronica, we've got Jago, and we've got in the back Tiana Spencer. who is a sex worker, who's also maybe her London accent slipped a little bit, and then Albie, one of her clients. So you were in the back of the car. You were saying you're going to go to a police station that will be closing soon. Mm-hmm. And you were going to try and conduct an interrogation there. Is that still what you would like to do, or would you like to do anything in between or before that, or deviate?
This is no... Veronica would like to deviate.
Okay.
Okay.
Not... She's not going to disrupt everything. But the first chance I have to get to a phone, I want to call in and check in with GCHQ, preferably without letting Jago know. I'm not trying to screw him over or anything like that, but we're getting up to a point where I think we need to do things by the book a little bit more. Veronica obviously is fine with what most of Jago does, but I was thinking about this between sessions.
Mm-hmm.
And I was trying to think of, like, Veronica, like, I know I've played her really silly so far, but I do have this, like, idea in mind of her where she is a little bit of a counter to Jago. And so if I get an opportunity, I want to check in with GCHQ and let them know that there might be some foreign interference.
Got it. Okay, so just for listeners at home, just so when you mean you want to check in with the circuit, you want to check in with your home base.
I said GCHQ.
Yeah, I know it doesn't really matter.
Right. We don't work for GCHQ. Yeah, I'm so sorry.
Circus. Yeah.
No, that's. I just wanted to make sure I got it.
Q. Who's our Q is our handler, right?
C.
C.
C for control. Okay. Okay. Cool. So you'd like to check in with the home office, so to speak.
Yeah.
Before you get okay,
and it can be while we're doing the interrogations or whatnot. I definitely want to make sure that Tiana, mm-hmm. if that's really her name, is secure. And I'll try to do some kind of excuse to just create a diversion for Jago. I'm not trying to get him in trouble or anything like that. I just, this one needs to move up the ladder a little bit.
Okay. And would you, so yeah, do you want to role play it out where we're trying to think of a reason to stop the car? Or do you want to just let it go till you get to the station and figure it out?
I think
there.
The station is fine. Okay. I mean, I'm nervous. I will tell you that. I'm a little bit nervous until we get her secure and in the station. Veronica is a little bit nervous about this whole situation. So I am alert.
Okay. What does Veronica do when she's nervous?
Well, she smokes.
Mm-hmm.
Albie's cigarettes.
Yeah, well, of course.
And I think she's just like, you know, like head on a swivel. She's checking the mirror. Like the mirror is set up so you can see out of it, but she just full on like grabs it herself and adjusts it so she can see perfectly out of the mirror. And Jago, make sure you take the back roads.
I mean, like, right, love. You all right there?
Something's not sitting right with this one, Jago.
Steady on, girl. Steady on. You'll be all right.
I think you need to calm down, miss. Cool. Okay, so, Patrick, why don't you have Jago give me a couple rolls here. Give me a drive roll. Why don't you both give me...
You're not
going
to hand wave driving.
Oh, God, no. I'm never hand waving anything again. why don't you both give me insight rolls? Not insight rolls. I'm sorry, perception rolls.
Okay. Let me pull up Veronica.
Perception. I'm sorry, you said perception, insight.
Perception.
Standard, I guess. Doesn't really matter.
Perception. I'm sorry.
I started to roll from my character sheet, and I was like, no, Art gave us these wonderful little things, so then I had to reverse what I was doing.
Sorry, I rolled from the character sheet.
That's fine.
Okay.
Yeah, so I'm going to assume, like, Jago, you don't just... you know, drive casual. Maybe you sort of go around the block once in a way that, like, if there's a tail, it'd be weird if they were still following you, that kind of stuff. You know,
yeah,
for...
Jago takes the scenic route always.
Got it. And you're not 100% sure. There's a brief window where you both start to look at each other and it's like those headlights. Are they still? And, you know, after a little while, you know, like, you know, Jago does some like evasive driving casually, and the headlights disappear. You think it's probably nothing. Veronica, you're not quite as sure. I think above the table, based on what you're sort of telling me, you're starting to get a little spidey senses tingling a little bit. Like, you're starting to get a little heightened.
I think so. Even though I don't pick it up, I think she's at least, she's on edge. Like, so maybe I don't pick up the headlights, but Veronica has started to process, like, this was all fun and games when it's just busting Albie's balls. She could give two shits less about Albie. I know there's a mission there, and right. she'll get that information from Albie regardless. But the presence of Tiana, and remind me, I think I asked this last time, but just as confirmation, when she slipped on her accent, could I tell at all what it was?
Not exactly specific. It was definitely Eastern Bloc. You couldn't tell if it was like...
I speak a little Finnish, but nothing.
Wasn't Finnish.
I remember German. I speak a good amount of German.
Yeah. And you haven't heard her slip with the accent, I don't think.
Okay. Okay.
So I
made up the whole thing about Finnish. Sorry, Patrick. You actually have a skill that lets you speak German.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. I just think Veronica spent some time in Finland, and also that's kind of, you know, she left a connection in Finland, and all of this is bringing up, opening up old wounds, and so hearing an Eastern Bloc accent,
All right. Okay. You're heightened, Jago. You think the headlights, maybe a little overstayed their welcome, but in the end. No big deal. And you make your way to the police station. And let's see. I know you can see the, you know, because sausage gets made, they can see my screen, but can you see the actual?
Yeah, we can see the room.
You can see the room. Good, good. Okay, cool. You've got Tiana in the room. You've got Albie in the room. And, you know, I'm going to...
Were we putting them in separate rooms?
Yeah, we'll assume they're in separate rooms. Okay. Yeah, I probably should have gotten a better graphic for that.
No, that's fine.
This works.
Yeah, so you got them in separate rooms. Things are getting situated. Matt, is this when Veronica would try and duck aside, or is she going to let things develop a little
Only
bit?
Only if I'm absolutely certain I can secure the room Tiana's in.
Okay, do you want to... persuade, you know, you want to sort of Jedi mind trick Jago into doing that, or do you just want to straight up ask him?
Hey, I mean, Jago, why don't you start in on Albie? Let me take the broad. I guess I wouldn't call her broad. Let me take
Right.
And is there a payphone in the hallway, Art?
Well, let's say there's a payphone. There'd also, if you wanted to use like a desk phone, some of them are still.
Yeah, up. I want the phone that is closest to Tiana's room.
Okay. Let's say outside of the room, you know, like the station's been mostly packed up and shipped off. There's still like a few empty desks, and maybe on the desk you just see like a landline with like the lone cable going into the wall, and you sort of pick it up. There's still a tone.
So I check the tone. I walk by Jago's room to make sure he's in there, and I grab a chair and I wedge it under the door handle of Tiana's room.
I thought you were doing that to my room. I was really
I thought as soon as I started to say it, I was like, man, should I do it to Jago's room? But I think this will be I don't know if it's that far. If I was doing something really bad, then I would.
Sure.
So I lock the door to the extent I can, and then I'm making the phone call to see.
Okay. Yeah, so you know, you get the switchboard, you put me through to see.
There's definitely a code phrase for like elevating calls directly.
Butter beer.
The butter beer is in the cuckoo's nest.
Very nice. All right. And it's like, oh, yes. One moment. And after a moment, Jing, 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 and all of a sudden
C is swimming laps right now, by the way. And a phone just gets handed to him. Like if we're doing a movie thing, it's just like he's in the deep end, but he just reaches up and grabs a phone. There's a cord and everything. Don't ask how.
It's actually George. George takes the call.
We like George.
You do, like yes. George. In fact, you sort of looked up to him a bit as like a father figure mentor kind of deal.
Yeah.
And you know, again, you can almost imagine him on the other side, sort of plump, lumpy in his chair, polishing his glasses with his tie. And he's like, oh yes, Veronica, how goes it?
Am I alarmed by this at all?
You were expecting, you were hoping to get through to C, but I don't think you're like, God damn it, it's DEFCON 5 and hang
I
up.
Didn't use the top secret. I used the, I need to talk to someone, I need to talk to someone now.
Yeah, and you got George.
Yeah, you didn't drop the beans on toast. You just did. Yeah. You just did butterbeer.
George, love, is that you?
It's like, oh yes, dear. It's good to hear from you. How goes it?
Sea swimming laps again.
Oh, indeed. It's his lunch hour. You know, he's trying to get away from the desk as much as he can.
Right. Here's the deal, love. And she's gonna inform him of. I think she'll even just like nonchalant, like, Albie's gonna sing like a bird. We'll know what GCHQ was doing there, but I'm trying to think how she would word this, and maybe she just there's a certain level of Eastern influence, and we've taken another individual into custody.
There's an Orthodox touch to it.
Nice, that's what I'm looking for. Yeah, and here's the deal, Georgie. Jago's gone a little bit off the books, but I thought this one should go up the chain a little bit.
As, like, if it's a movie, when he says Jago's gone off the books, like, Albie's face gets pressed up against the glass in the room next door. You hear, like, the chair getting thrown around, and like...
You clock like, him with a book right when I say off the
yeah,
books.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. He's like eating. I'm pushing his teeth in with the phone book at the moment. Yeah, like.
Very nice. I don't like metaphors. They're for Episcopalians. I need it to be very literal. That's good. You like, oh, interesting. And George sort of is like, And he's not one to. He's never going to be the guy that goes like, holy shit, it's go time. Yeah. But you can tell he's just going, huh. And it might be the first time where you realize it's not that he is choosing not to speak. He actually doesn't know what to say. Mm. So, and he's just kind of like, well, you know, this might warrant interrupting Control's lunch. I do appreciate the information. And what's the number we can reach you at? And, you know, he's at
me. She looks around and there's just like, scrap paper, and there's a newspaper from 2 weeks ago, and I'll tell you what, Georgia, I'll give you a buzz in 10 minutes.
Sounds good. And
and I purposely don't give the location. I don't want to completely spoil Jago's fun.
Okay.
But you let us know. You talk to C. I want to talk to C too. Let us know if we need to come in.
Sounds good. Okay. And let's cut over to you, Jago.
Is a sock with a handful of just British pound notes in it. And I'm like, okay, Albie. Listen, love. This could go really easily, really quickly. Now, I've already knocked out a couple of your teeth.
Hold on. Pound notes or pound coins? Because that's a very different sock. Like you just hit it with like 10 $5 bills.
It's the lightest sock you've ever seen. Oh no, I had a phone book. That's what I had before. It was the notes, by the way. It wasn't the coins.
Wadding cash into a sock. This can go one of two ways.
And he's like, I don't understand. <You're right. laughs> What am I supposed to be feeling?
So like, I'm like wiping his teeth off of my shoulder or something, like something horrible. Right, love. Well, like smack him on the cheek a little bit. Wakey, wakey, Albie. what's the connection here, love? Because I'm the good cop in this situation. You really don't want Veronica to come in here, do you, love?
And he looks up at you. He's like, what are you talking? What are you doing? We're on the same side. I'm a British citizen. Why are you...
Why are you beating him?
No, you're just my bitch in this closet here. There's no citizenship in my interrogation room.
And he's just like, I need to get on the phone with GCHQ right now.
No.
All right. And we're going to now jump over to Veronica. You've hung up the phone. And I assume you enter the room. Do you let her stew some more? What are you going to do?
I very slowly slide the chair out from the door. And it's the slowest latch noise on a lock. And I slowly open the door. And I sit across from her. Oh, and when I won't lock the door. I was going to lock the door, like lock us in there. I won't do that. I won't be so dramatic. But I sit down and I just start smoking and I stare at her for a very long and uncomfortable period of time. Like, I know I said I'd call in 10 minutes. So I'm saying, like, I stare at her for 8 minutes without flinching, just smoking my cigarette.
All right. And she doesn't flinch either. Why don't you give me an insight roll? Or a tradecraft, whichever is higher. It's the standard difficulty.
Okay.
I'll leave it up to you if you want to augment it with a...
No, this is fine.
Great roll.
Baby. Oh, baby.
Great roll.
Holy shit.
For listeners, Veronica rolled a 4, which basically is a critical up to a hard. This was a standard check, so it was a critical success. And she's relying on training.
Mm.
She's...
So 8 minutes go by, mm-hmm. and then I get it, and I just smile. And then I get up. Does she have a cigarette?
No.
Okay. I get up. I take her beret and I leave the room. Lock it. Very slow and methodical. It takes 2 minutes for me to lock the door and put the chair. And then I walk back and I make a phone call.
Nice. Back to Jago. Albie. What's that?
I have to ask, while you were staring for 8 minutes across the table at each other, is it like a vent between the two rooms? Just the soft, muffled, screams of Albie. Yeah, and a swish of a sock full of, pound notes. So.
Do you hear leaves?
No, it's like the most relaxing.
What is Albie doing? Like, I plop down in the chair across from him, like, exhausted at this point.
So, yeah, so you've physically injured Albie, right? You knocked out a couple of teeth, beat him up a little bit.
Okay. Yes.
Really escalated.
So, he, at first he was taking the first couple of hits, and he's like, I don't understand, I'm a British citizen, I need to talk to my boss, I need to talk to Mr. Webb. I'm a, an officer of GCHQ. How dare you? We're in the same service. What are you doing? And then by the end of that 10 minutes, he's just crying. It's like, I don't understand what you were doing. I don't understand what you're doing. And why are you hitting me? Stop it.
I haven't asked him a single question in the 10 minutes either. No.
That, right. No. He's just like,
I'm just beating the shit out of this guy for 10 minutes. And as I sit down and he's blubbering into the and dripping drool and blood and tears onto the floor, I said, so Finland, what's going on this time of year in Finland, my friend? Let's talk about Finland.
Yeah, and he sort of looks at you for a minute. And he's like, you have to ask Mr. Webb. I could lose my job.
And then I'll just slowly reach into the jacket pocket, and slip on the brass knuckles. They're like, look, pound notes in a sock hurt a certain level, but we could truly escalate this situation to DEFCON 1 if you'd like. And I don't think, given how much you've cried for your mama in the last 10 minutes, I really don't think that you could stand up to it. You're really and truly a disgrace to the crown and the agencies that you serve. And I really don't want to have to even waste the effort to extract this from you. So why don't you just go ahead and save us both the time and spit it out?
All right. Pause that. Matt, you stepped out of the room. Mm-hmm. You realize that Tiana's relying on training. You're mm-hmm. about to make a phone call. Jocko doesn't know what's going on with Tiana.
He has no idea.
Mm-mm.
Do you want to...
Not yet.
Okay. So you hop back on the phone.
I still think it's important to get C involved. So okay. this time I'll... the cards are a royal flush.
And the person on the other end goes, holy shit. And, the phone's ringing. You're going to assume it's C's red phone on his desk, because a moment later, he's like, Veronica, dear, is that you? And it's C.
Mm-hmm.
And he's like, I'm here. You know, George is filling me in a little bit. Got me out of the pool, so I hope it's important.
Yes, C. Things have escalated for a moment. We believe we'll be able to get the information we need, but you ought to know there's a certain level of Eastern influence here.
Go on.
We're dealing with a professional.
And he's like, professional.
Got a name for you, C. I'm sure it's a cover, but Tiana Spencer.
He's like, of course, and he sort of jots that down, and you can hear the paper ripping, and you're just assuming he's giving it to George. Yeah. And you hear in the background the door open and close.
Some Eastern block, no doubt about it, but she's been trained.
Interesting.
And she's been keeping an eye on Mr. Spencer.
Interesting. And does she seem to have any connection to this Finland business?
Oh, I'd say her and Albie are quite connected. But I thought I ought to let you know that they're both in custody. And we're doing things a little off the book. But I thought it was high time we check in.
And then for a moment he pauses like, I'm sorry, excuse me, you're telling me Miss Spencer is in custody.
Yes, so is Albie. I guess she'd probably refer to, so is Mr. Graham.
And just like, you can sort of hear like I'm sucking on his lip a little bit.
Yeah, it's clicking with Veronica too that we've brought a potentially Russian person into custody, mm-hmm. like violating all kinds of things here. I mean, not official custody, but
right.
She is literally in an interrogation room, though.
Yeah. So with that, he's like, dear, you've done excellent work. I think we should keep this off the books a little bit longer.
Mm.
Music to Jago's ears.
I would like to come to you with Mr. Murray, if you'll permit me the name of your location. And I'd very much like to maybe get more involved if you'd just tell me where you're at.
Can I make an insight roll?
Go ahead.
Or a perception roll?
Mm-hmm. Insight.
Insight. Yeah.
Flip it. Flip it. Flip it.
No, it's good. That's good. 30's good.
Okay.
But
you're not...
Flip it to a critical success?
Mm-hmm.
Am I up to 3 luck points again?
Yes, you should. We probably should have done our skill bumps, but
that's
yeah.
okay. We had a short session last time.
Yeah.
I'll flip it to make it a critical.
Okay. So you make it a 3, right?
Yeah.
It seems... It's definitely not by the book. It definitely, you're like... I don't understand why C would want to get personally involved, but So to you, there does seem to be something weird about it as a whole.
I'm going to press it a little bit further. See, permission to... I guess she probably wouldn't be that formal.
Right.
Mr. C, are you sure? We have a... And she holds the phone up down the hall just as Albie, like, screams out. We brought a British citizen in.
And C is like, wait, dear God, is that the citizen? Did I just hear?
Yes, are you sure you really want to get your hands dirty, sir?
I think I need to. I think you need to stop whatever's going on in that other room, and I think I need to know where you're at. And we might need to damage control this a little bit.
See, you assigned us and told us at whatever cost, no matter how high.
She's like, I think I specifically said, remember, he's still a British citizen. And we just have to compromise him.
But sir, this has escalated.
Yes, yes, I know. It's escalated on a lot of different fronts. there's about 10 fires now I'm going to have to put out with GCHQ. I mean, we do have to work with these people. Yeah, why don't you...
Don't you feel like he's the least of our concerns? There is a Russian asset sitting inside the room right now.
And that's when C goes, oh dear, you need to learn the difference between a Russian spy and a full-blown scandal. And he's sort of saying it in sort of like a tsk, 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 like, oh, you haven't been around the block yet. There's spies everywhere. But what's happening in the other room is going to be the front page of the London Standard or whatever. And it's going to be the biggest black eye the circus has had in quite a while, since Bay of Pigs.
So with all due respect, I think Albie's far more disgraceful to what Jago's doing to him inside.
And he's like, I really need to know where you are. Mm. And we need
let
to
me get the let me add let me get the address from Jago. I'll call you back. And she hangs up.
Interesting. All right. And as you're hanging up, he's like, I don't think that's click. So back to Jago. Albie's just a crying mess. You know, I think you've asked him what's going on in Finland. He said he could lose his job.
Mm-hmm.
How
mm-hmm.
do you follow up on that?
I had slipped on the brass knuckles.
Oh, right. And you're just like...
Yeah.
Okay.
We haven't actively moved to that part yet.
Okay.
But so I'll be like you did, tapping them on the table. I'm like, right, you are a sovereign British citizen, and that does give you some rights in some circles. And you do work across the river from us, and that also gives you some rights in some circles. You're not in any of those circles right now. So I just need to know what's going on in Finland, and I won't tell your wife that you've been screwing anything that moves from one end of London to the other. And you can go home and tell her that you ran into the biggest door you've ever run into in your entire life. And you could tell your boss that you fell down some stairs after you hit the door. And we can end this conversation. Mm. And we can move on. I really don't like doing this to people.
Okay, so he has the quivering upper lip. You can tell he's terrified. And he's gonna... Did I fill anything out? I don't think I did. He is going to... It's very sheepish. Mm-hmm. It's almost like he's, you know... Hey. But he gathers one last time, I could lose my job. He tries to put on the brave, whimpering face one more time and hope for the best.
Is the table bolted to the ground?
What would you like it to be? Is it better one way or another for you?
No. I would like it to not be bolted to the ground.
There you go.
So I will...
It's bolted, no.
So as he's whimpering and putting on his last... Can I tell that it's his last, like, reserve of courage here? Like, is it fairly obvious at this point?
He's just like a moment away from wetting himself, but he knows this is what he's supposed to do.
I'm gonna go full like angry English dude in traffic in London, and I'm gonna flip the table to the side, and I'm gonna grab my chair and go shove it in the, I'm gonna do the opposite of what Matt did and shove it in the door so that he can't get in. And I'm just gonna just scream at him like, you fucking wuss. Like, I just need you to fucking grow a spine for 2 seconds, stand up for what you did, stand up for yourself, and tell me what the fuck you did in Finland.
All right. So, Matt, you were outside of the talking on the phone, and you hear a table go end over end after C just said, shit's getting a little out of control. You need to shut that down.
I was about to open the door, right? And then I hear the table erupt, and I give it like 30 seconds, and then I knock. Like, I want him to do his thing. I don't want to disrupt that, but now I'm at the point where I'm going to tell Jago what's up.
Okay. Go ahead, Jago.
Go ahead. I was going to say, has he pissed himself at this point?
Yeah, there's definitely... it's full piss, standing in a puddle.
Good.
And he's like, I don't understand. Why is this happening to me? Why is this? And you know, he's just full blubber.
And I'll take the brass knuckles off and put them in my coat, and, like, fix my shirt and pop the collar or whatever. Just a moment. Well, half a mo. And I'll turn around and I'll unwedge the chair from under the door, and I'll open the door, and I've got like blood splatters all over my face and everything. Yes, love.
She peers around his shoulder and she looks down at Albie. Says, "Oh, Albie. I don't know if Helen's money will pay for all this cleanup. Don't you want to end this?" And I'm gonna give him like 5 seconds to respond before I tell Jago what I'm in here to tell Jago.
Right, and at this point, Albie's just crying. He's like, "You can let me go home. I just want to go home. I don't want to deal with any of this anymore. I'll quit. I don't care. You tell me."
So he's still not saying. He's still not telling.
No, he hasn't said anything yet. To Jago,
last chance, Albie. I really must talk to Jago, and if we come back in this room, it'll be me, and you do not want me in this room.
And he's like, it can't be any worse than him, and he can't.
I'll turn around and say, oh, yes, she can be.
And he's like, I just want to go home. I just want to see my wife and my kid. I don't understand what's going on. I have rights. I have rights.
Jago, a moment. I'll see you soon, Albie.
And I'll step outside, close the door quietly, very calmly. What's up, love?
Here's the deal. I made a call into C.
Right.
Tiana next door. Obviously isn't who she says she is, and I think we've gone international. Here's the hiccup. C wants to come in on this, but something feels off. He didn't ask for us to come in. He wants to come here.
That doesn't sound like C. He's very much a hands-off man.
I may have told him that he wants to leave his hands off of this one. Considering that you're beating out of our...
I'll look down at my hands and be like,
So, how do we play this?
Well, I mean, he is our boss. It is weird, but not to sound like pussyfooting there, but I really don't want to lose my job over this. I do quite enjoy it. Can I roll a trying to think. Like, can I roll a bureaucracy to see, like, what rules is this man breaking right now? Like, like, what is this guy, what, like, why would he want to get involved? What would he be avoiding if he gets involved?
Oh, what C's rules?
Correct. Yeah. Oh, what is, nice. what is C trying to get around if he's coming down here? Mm. Like, is there some weird, like, backdoor loophole Unix system bullshit that he's trying to play with this?
Yeah, obviously. Yeah, definitely. Go ahead. Give it a bureaucracy. Yeah.
I'll use the correct one this time.
Bureaucracy. And, okay, so you would need a difficulty level.
Yeah.
And the difficulty level for this, I'm going to say, is formidable because he's privy to things that you don't know about. So you're sort of having to, like, fill in a lot of blank spaces. Like, wait, well, it could be, but I don't really know how that works or what he would know about this or what's going on. So let's make it formidable.
All right.
Oh, shit. Hell yeah.
Let's fucking go.
Nice.
Tell us all your secrets, Art.
Yeah. So there's a lot of different things that it could be. One, bigger play at work. There's, like, a larger operation at play. He's trying to protect some secret. He's trying to protect himself. He's trying to protect the agency again, because it's, you know, a couple different things. You guys are MI6. Internal spies is more MI5. So that's a peculiarity. Trying to think what else. Is there anything you'd like to ask?
You're not mentioning an obvious one, Art.
What's that?
He could be betraying his country.
Yeah, I mean, that could be on the table. I mean, like, if you're going to come up with the realm of possibilities, that you can't take that off the table.
Has he been under any heat lately at the office? Like, has he had any even stuff like scuttlebutt that we wouldn't, you know, it's not going to be front page news. Like, has an operation gone sideways recently? Like,
well, Finland.
Well, sure. Besides Finland.
Finland, though, was not the Circus's operation. That was GCHQ.
It wasn't the Circus, but it would normally fall under the Circus, right?
Right, right. And that was part of the pissing match going into it, was like, why is the Circus not doing this? Why is GCHQ going rogue a little bit? You may or may not remember from the opening description, George Murray had a very high-profile mission go very, very well until the last second, where it went right down the toilet with the loss of an agent and an asset trying to get over the Berlin Wall. That was maybe a year ago. George Murray was never the same since. And maybe you sense some degree of obligation from C about George Murray taking that one, because it was a win for the Circus, but it came at a high cost for George Murray personally, losing that asset. There's a lot of... So specifically, it's not like, you know, there's, you know, C's getting in the full court press investigation, but... You know, so you could sense that there's something about that mission between George and C that, you know, again, obligation from C towards George. But you don't know, again, but it could have just been like the mission was that important. Like you said, there could be a million different things. He could be betraying his country. He could be, you know, trying to protect the Circus, or trying to, you know, because it's all like... you know, level 3 degree serious political knife fighting, right? It's like you take your shots at the rival agencies where you can to sort of keep in daddy's favor, you know.
Right. Get the money flowing to the right coffers.
Right, right. So, but it's not something specific like, you know, files have gone missing last week and now the whole place is turned upside down kind of thing.
Okay. Mm. Okay. And obviously I would pass all that kind of takeaway to Veronica. Right. I think we might need to move safe houses again. For the good of Albie, right? And I like nod. Like I think maybe we should take a drive up country.
Jargo, give me 1 minute with both of them. Separately.
Right.
You pull the car around.
I can do that.
Right outside the door.
Right outside or inside?
Yeah, it's right outside this door.
We can hand wave where you parked.
Yeah. Inside the lobby again.
Exactly.
Right.
Do we need to break away to roleplay his parking or?
No, we're gonna come back to his parking. Matt,
okay, good.
So, Jago, are you down with that? Or are you down for?
No, Jago is a street level guy. Like, once we get too high above this stuff, like, he's gonna defer to Veronica. Like, I got an ear for the bullshit at the office water cooler, but other than that, this is starting to get a little hot and heavy for Jago, even with the sock full of pound notes. Like, So Jago's happy to take a step out of this. Like he's good for bruising, but he's right. I'll go get the car.
Yeah, because
Jago.
Oh, sorry. Go ahead.
How many pairs of handcuffs do you have on you?
Art, how many pairs of handcuffs? Jago doesn't have any on him, but he'll like walk over to a desk and be like, "Right, this used to be Pinkening's desk," and I'll like pull the bottom drawer out and it's like six or seven pairs. I'm like, fucker, and hand them to you.
One big key ring.
Exactly. All
right. I walk into Albie's room.
Okay.
I light up a cigarette and I set the table back up. And I handcuff him to the table. I understand that it's not fixed in place. But I handcuff him to something in the room. And I check my watch. I say, "Albie, do you know where we're at?"
And he's like, "No. I mean, it looks like a police station."
Yeah, it's a police station. You heard the news recently?
Like, no, I was out all night, at the office, that, and then been at work all
out
day.
Out all night in poor Miss Spencer, huh? "Albie, do you know what today is?"
He's like, "Is it, I guess it's late Wednesday?"
"Is it late Wednesday?"
Yeah, let's say, like, it's getting towards, like, dinner time of Wednesday, yeah.
"Oh, just in time for the 6 o'clock telly. Here's the deal. Albie, we're inside Kensington Station, which you may have heard is being converted to whatever the big fucking station in London is. And, oh, would you look at the date, Albie? Today is the day that they're going to demolish Kensington Station." Oh. And then she clasps the other part of the handcuffs. Like, now it's around him. "So, here's the deal, Albie. I've got to be out of here in 2 minutes. Enough bullshit. Tell me about Finland."
He's like, you're not going to leave me here. You can't just leave me here to die.
"Albie, we can. We can. And we will. You know my reputation."
Let's see. Give me... I'll let you tell me... It could be human. It could be... medic on some level. Like... basically, he's starting to get hysterical. And I think you need to talk him down enough a little bit because he thinks he's about to die. And that's flooding.
Okay. Let's do human.
Okay. And I don't know if you want to try and... it's a good roll. Okay. So you see he's starting to get really unhinged.
"Albie,
and how do you calm
Albie,
him down?
Albie, there's a way out of this, love. I'm not a bad person. I've done bad, bad, awful things, but those don't have to happen to you. Here's what we do. I unlock those handcuffs. We drop you off to to Miss Helen. I'll even have Jago drop you off so Miss Helen's not suspicious anymore. You get access to Daddy-in-Law's trust fund. You keep your job. No one's the wiser, and you're fine. Trust me, Albie. If you work with me, no more harm will come to you. And she, like, picks up a $5 banknote, kind of wipes it off, and puts it in Albie's chest pocket.
And he's like, you let me go? You're
yes,
not going to
Albie.
Die?
I'm not a... Yes. But you have to tell me. And she looks down at her watch.
And, yeah, he's like, shit, yeah. No, yeah, I'll tell you. Mr. Taylor, he had to go to Finland. He was supposed to meet somebody.
More, Albie?
He's like, I don't know too much more than that. It was just... It was a pilot. It was a Captain Lanson.
Captain Lanson, Albie, you're not withholding any information from me, are you?
He's like, no, I swear to God, I helped set up his paperwork to get in, which, if you remember from the original session, was dog shit. And yeah, he was off to go meet with the Captain Lanson. I don't know what it was about. It was between Mr. Taylor and Mr. Webb. When Mr. Taylor died, that's when Mr. Webb sort of called me in to help take over some of his duties. I wasn't actually that high up. It was just when, Mr. Taylor died that, I sort of got bumped up a little bit in emergency.
She pulls out a syringe from her, jacket or whatever. And she lets Albie see it. And she goes behind his neck. And she pinches him really hard with her nails and then applies the plunger. Albie, focus. And, I didn't inject him with anything. Albie, focus. Focus. You wouldn't believe the things that they're coming up with over at MI6 these days. Do you know that we can track people via scent and satellites?
Yes.
And so, if I found out you're lying... I'm gonna come find you.
All right. Let's pause that for a second.
Hold on.
Oh, sorry. Go ahead.
Before we transition out, I'm gonna start walking to the door without unhandcuffing him.
And he's just like, you gotta let me out of here. Oh, I told you everything I know. What did you stick in me?
Now, you're gonna be quiet, aren't you? Albie, remember, the satellites can smell you.
And he's wiggling in his chair.
You're what, Albie?
So, over to Patrick.
Hold on, I have a thing.
Oh, sorry, go ahead. You tell me when. No, okay, sorry.
What's does he say? He's not going to be quiet?
Yeah, he's okay.
All right. So then I toss him the whole fucking key ring.
And then he's like, and it lands by his feet and he can't quite reach it. So he's like trying to drag it over with his shoe. And then you sort of see him barely snagging the ring with his pinky. And are you leaving the room or are you watching?
Yeah, I leave the room.
Okay.
Yeah, I leave the room. I wedge a door in it just to, like, not to lock him in there. You're like, the building comes down at 1:30, Albie. All right, now we can cut to Patrick.
Okay, yeah, and you can just hear him, like, trying. God damn it, that's not it. Patrick, tell me about the parking.
Yes. The most incredible parallel parking job you've ever seen. And like Jago gets out and like whistles at how well he pulls up into this parallel parking. Like are there actually demolition guys around? Like,
no, I'm
okay. All right,
but all right, Albie hears the car engine and thinks it's a fucking bulldozer or something.
Oh God, it's happening.
But yeah, like Jago gets out and he's like, He's visibly dejected that nobody else is there to see what an incredible parking job it is. He's
very
like,
nice. And because, you know what, give me a drive roll.
Oh shit.
Because we're not hand waving any of this ever again.
Oh no.
Okay. Even though this is an abandoned police station, you're not able to get one of the spots closest to the door. Maybe there's like some rubble or like a tipped over street light has sort of fallen. So you actually have to, it's a beautiful parking job. I'll let you PBTA that. But it's a little bit further out and you're just like, Jesus, an empty parking lot and I still have to walk.
Yeah.
Okay, back inside.
I need to step away for 2 seconds. You guys keep going.
Okay.
Back.
I step in Tiana's room.
Okay.
I'm doing the same fucking shtick, but this time I'm more like, more serious.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not rough with her, but I do like, she starts to pull her wrist away maybe when I grab it, and then like I really firmly grab it and slap the cuffs on her. I say, Tiana, do you know where we're at, love?
And she won't talk.
Oh, that's okay. I'll tell you. Kensington Station. Are you familiar? Nah, you're gonna stay quiet, huh? And then I. So this is a charming little. I don't know why I'm doing Australia, but that's what keeps happening. This is a charming little police station. My dad was actually served as a cop here for 25 years. Believe it or not. And, well, it moved. Big new fancy building downtown. Hard to beat, but this is just wasted space now. And, tonight's the night it comes down. And I slap the other end of the cuffs around something in the room. So, Tiana, you have about 2 minutes before I walk out that door. And then another 3 minutes before this whole building goes up with you in it. But you can prevent that.
Give me an insight roll.
Okay.
Make it standard.
Okay. Standard insight. Why didn't that come up? Oh, I'd have my character selected this way. 64.
Okay.
Even flipping it wouldn't do it.
No, wouldn't solve that. She doesn't seem to react. You can't tell. She's been pretty stone-faced the whole time, but usually you can, like, did her eye twitch? Did her lip curl? You didn't catch any of those sort of, like, micro expressions that you might look for to tell you whether or not somebody who's not really communicating is going for what you're saying.
I put a cigarette in her mouth, and I put the lighter up, and I'm like, sorry, I shouldn't assume, love. If it were me, I'd want one more smoke before I go.
And she sort of looks at you for a minute and then kind of nods.
So I light it for her.
She takes a nice drag and sort of lets it dangle just a little bit in her lips as she blows out the corner.
I look at my watch. Look, love. If you are who I think you are, then you know who I am and what I am capable of and what I have done. I'm walking out that door in 45 seconds.
And
I put a beret on the table.
Right.
And then I walk over by the door.
She takes another long drag on the cigarette.
I unlock the door.
She kind of lets it dangle and blows out the corner of her mouth.
Goodbye, Tiana.
Takes one more drag.
Shut the door.
All right. You left. Shut the door. Or do you just...
Yeah, yeah.
Okay, yeah, yeah, yeah. Okay. So as you're coming out of the door, Jago, you're coming in from the parking lot. Sort of
a
mixture.
You wouldn't believe how far I came from the parking lot.
I was about to say, it's just sort of like the highs and the lows of the job, right? Like, goddamn perfect parking. But man, was it like in a little bit of a rough spot of the lot. So you're coming in the door. You see Veronica closing the door to Tiana's room. And what do you do?
I'll just cock an eyebrow. Right? Everything good?
I'll be singing like a bird and got everything we thought we could from him. Easy peasy. He won't say a word. You know, those new satellites. And she slips him a wink. I must confess, Jago, Tiana might have called my bluff. Give it about 20 seconds. and right. I'll walk at the other end of the hall and I'll slam a door. And then I wait to hear if I hear anything.
When she does that, Jago, he'll pull a cigarette from behind his ear or something and put it in loose, like it's hanging like way down like a walrus tooth. And I'll light it, and I'm, you know, but that's just like my thinking man's, like that's what I do. I just let it hang really low. Ronica, I think that there's the electrical box, the lecky box is down in the basement. I think I might take a walk down there. Make her think the whole place is coming down, eh? I'll be back in a jiff. And I'll start meandering that way.
Nice.
Right. When you slam the door, you don't immediately hear, assume, a response from
okay.
Albie's room. Oh god, I still haven't found the key. But from Tiana's room.
I completely forgot about fucking
please, Jesus, let me find the key. Yeah, it's but Tiana, you didn't hear anything.
Alright. I'm quiet as a church mouse. What happens when Albie flips the breakers?
Jago flips the breakers.
Yeah, Jago, sorry.
You hear Albie going, God, they told me they weren't going to let me die in here. Oh my God, please, God, let this be the key. I just want to see my kid one more time. Oh my God, please. You know, I'll stop doing anything, God, if you just let me get out of here. From Tiana's room, you hear sort of a, and then it cuts itself off.
Nothing.
Just a quick, like, almost like it escaped unintentionally, but then she was able to clench it back down.
Not enough for me to burst in there.
So you see Jago's head pop up from like the stairs where he's at, but it's, you don't see him. It's just like there's like a red like emergency light is on behind him, and the glow from the end of his cigarette is like, what else can I do for you, love? What other trouble can I cause? I think the water heater was down here. Might be able to make that blow.
Oh, nice. I love it.
So, right, two shakes, love. And I'll, like, look for something really, really heavy. And, like I'm dragging a desk, like, really loudly. Like, in the basement or something, just a really heavy piece of furniture. Like, that's where all the spare chairs and shit are kept. I'm just making as much loud noise as I can down there.
Do a call out, like, final charge set.
Yep. Charges are set, sir. And, but, you know, the camera pans down there, and I'm, like, turning the valves on the steam to make it go up or whatever. Like, cigarettes still dangling, and I'm, like, stuffing, like, oily rags up in other openings, like, right.
Feeding the furnace like a bunch of shit.
All right. Right, just like I used to do back on a farm when I wanted to give Pappy the absolute shit for the day.
I flew up our hot water heater, which was new when you were a child.
I had to give Pappy the shit. So, and I'm like, and I'll come around the corner and I'll, again, just the glow from the end of the cigarette, I'll take a deep drag so that it illuminates my whole face, and I'll slow nod. Give it another. Give it about 2 minutes there, love.
Anything from inside?
Albie's like, oh god, I think I found the key. Oh, thank you, God. Oh god, no, it's still not the key. Oh god, how can it not still be the key?
As he's saying all of that, as a callback to our previous shenanigans with pickpocketing and
you
stuff,
have
I'll... The glow of the cigarette will catch just the slightest glint from, like, the keys around my neck or something. I'll take it out. Like, nick that from you on my way out to the car. This absolute theater of the mind. absolutely pitch perfect. I want to hear him scream like he ain't got no balls left.
From Tiana's room, a couple more. But again, not like wailing, not screaming, not...
Okay. What happens when the hot water heater blows?
Does 2 minutes pass?
Yeah, so describe to me the hot water heater blowing.
You know what happens when a hot water heater blows?
No, I've never actually had a hot water heater blow.
So it shoots up like a fucking rocket.
So, but I'm picturing this place is like a brick shit house. So even if it goes straight up, it's just going to like bounce around on all these cinder block, like on all these really thick cinder block walls.
Can we just say it shoots up through Albie's fucking like, doesn't kill him or anything like that. It just goes completely
perfect. Maybe it doesn't even, you rigged it.
It's brilliant. But
it doesn't
just,
even.
Like,
I don't think it goes through. It just it hits with enough force directly under his chair to like bounce him out of the chair. Yeah.
And like, her. Let's say yes. And her too. And then like, you know, like drywall and dust and shit comes down from the lights and stuff. Like it's enough maybe to.
Yeah.
If this is strong enough to withstand a. that would be something if it didn't pierce. I'm sure there would be quite the explosion.
Yeah, let's say it literally damages the floor in his room, maybe it cracks, there's a bit of a hole. And you know, you're looking up at Albie and he's looking up down at you.
Yeah.
And he's just like, you goddamn psychopaths, none of these keys work. You told me you weren't gonna leave me here to die. What's wrong with you? I'm a British citizen. I have a child.
As he does that, I'll toss him the key. I'll finally have a moment. But just outside of his reach, like it's on the floor, like 3 feet away from him.
So yeah, he like he's hopping the chair and he just tips it over in desperation, and so, you know, Veronica, the dust is settling in the main office room, and all of a sudden you hear thud, you know, of Albie hitting the floor, and then like as he drags the chair, and then, but again in Tiana's room. You can tell she's like, and then give me a perception roll.
Okay. I do have a concern, but I'll roll this. I mean, because here's the deal: if she doesn't talk, then she's gonna completely call my bluff. I'm also a little bit worried that, I mean, I don't know why. I don't know if she would. I don't know if she would harm herself to like expedite things.
She's in there taking her cyanide pill right now.
Oh, can I flip that?
Yeah.
I'll flip that.
So even though you don't, looking at your character sheet, even though you don't speak the language, she definitely screams something out when the explosion happens, something, and it's like, that's Russian, that's Ukrainian, that's 100%, like, it's not just her accent slipping. It's she called out, she screamed out in her native tongue.
That's a rare dialect from Eastern Poland, spoken in only two villages that war with each other across water rights to a creek. I could identify it anywhere.
So that's what you hear. But, you know, maybe you hear sort of like her chair, like she's sort of trying to bang out of her chair a little bit. She's trying to, you know, hop and see if she can break it. She's trying to do something. She's not just passively taking it, but yeah.
Resilience, little. I'll give a shrug to Jago. Or is he in the? Is he below? Is he below?
I think I'll have come back up.
Oh, like, okay. I give a shrug, and like I'll point at the door, like. Should I go in?
You're pointing at the door, you're looking, and I like pull my boot revolver out and I'm like checking it. I'm like, you know, you could always shoot a kneecaps out.
Out of curiosity, I sort of knew what happened when a water heater exploded. What I don't know is how loud is a water heater exploding?
Super loud, I would imagine.
ChatGPT.
I was going to YouTube.
Without putting me on a watch list, how loud is it when a water heater explodes?
Jugga's gonna have to run interference for the crazy cat lady that lives next door.
I just watched the Mythbusters thing. It's pretty fucking loud.
Okay. So
and there's steam, like it would generate, it looks like it generates steam and shit.
Right. So there's steam coming up through the floor, you know, it's sort of going out some of the cracked windows that just broke when the thing went up. So there's steam coming out of the windows a little bit, and you hear way off in the distance sirens.
I unlock the door and I kick it in and I take my jacket off and I wrap it around her head. I grab her beret and I start pulling her out of the room.
Okay. And Jaga, what are you up to?
Did Albie get his cuffs off at this point?
Yeah. So say like, as this is happening, like he opens the door and he's got like one cuff still dangling from his wrist and he's kind of shaking and I just want to go home. I just want to go home. And maybe a teeny bit of blood armor coming down his ear because he just burst his eardrum from the explosion.
So I'll roll down my sock and pull out a couple of 5-pound notes and hand them to him and like put him in his jacket pocket or his shirt pocket and like pat the
but
side of
his.
You
feel the $5 note that I put in there.
And I'm like,
you take one back.
I'm like, shit, you're getting out of here. You're going to be richer than I am. And stick it in there and I'll say, call yourself a black cab from the local pub. That's a good lad.
And it's almost like a hypnotic trance where he's going to do what you say. He just sort of stumbles out. He doesn't even acknowledge what you said. He just sort of walks out the door and just kind of looks around because he has no idea where he is. And he just picks a direction and starts walking.
Is Tiana out in, like, are you guys out into the main, like, lobby at this point?
Yeah.
Yeah, I kicked the side of her knee in.
Nice.
All right.
You help me scoop her up?
Yep, absolutely.
And, so she starts, like, trying to, you know, I assume she's still cuffed in some capacity.
Yeah.
But, she's definitely trying to bite, scrape, kick, scratch, whatever she can possibly muster while you're trying.
But her face is covered. Like, I did, like, wrap my... Yeah.
Yeah. But, Jaga, why don't you give me... Give me a... This is tough. You're not strong. I keep picturing you as somebody you're not. Give me a brawn roll as you're trying to hold her while she's trying to...
Oh, dear.
66. Okay. There's no way to flip that. So...
Well, you could.
So you are doing that, and she sort of wiggles free and sort of drops to her knees and starts to get up and tries to start getting up.
Yeah, no. Jago is not playing with that. Jago is going to actually pull his revolver out and, like, cock it. And I'm sure if she's this... I don't know anything about this chick still besides the fact that she's, you know... resisting us at this point, but she should know what the sound of a revolver hammer cocking is,
right? Yeah, let's say she just instantly, as soon as that sound happens, she freezes and let's fade to black. There we go.
Very nice.
Is this remotely close to how you thought tonight's session was gonna go? All of a sudden, just to recap, we beat the shit out of Albie without actually asking him any questions. I'm highly suspicious of the head of MI6. Don't trust him. And we just blew up a water heater to try to intimidate a trained spy.
So here's when you were saying you were going to play it by the book. I was like, okay, C and George are going to come into the picture. And so I was anticipating what would happen when they became a part of this little circle. So I thought it was interesting when you held off. I liked that Patrick got a good enough bureaucracy. So your bureaucracy was a success on...
Basically everything, wasn't it?
Basically everything, because what I was looking for to give you as much information as I could possibly think of was like a Herculean success.
Yeah.
And you got it. Yeah. And so then I was just like, yeah, like it could be, you know, he's just trying to help the agency. It could be he's, you know, protecting himself for some reason. He could be trying to portray like nothing was off the table because because you suddenly realize like, oh shit, there's a lot of reasons why somebody might be doing this in this slightly hanky way. Yeah, what did you guys think was going to happen tonight?
Well, so I did think about this session a good amount, especially with the last week, because again, I was trying to imagine like, when does Veronica stop being a caricature and start being this badass femme fatale she is? And then I thought, well, like, okay, at some point I gotta start doing that. And then also at some point she probably isn't completely off the books. Like, she does respect the rules. I don't know if it was just you or I happened to like switch back from Foundry when you were playing role playing as C. I switched back into StreamYard so I could see you, and then I thought of our game of Liminal Horror where like the characters were the tipping point as to something's not right here. Now that was very ham-fisted, like he didn't even know where the coffee pot was or things like that. And then when you said they wanted to get involved and he didn't answer the phone in the first place, I was like, oh no, something's up here. So no, not how I saw it going. I was very well like prepared to bring them in, but when they said they wanted to come to us, not how I imagined the night at all.
Yeah.
Nice. Yeah, I mean,
what about you, Patrick?
Yeah,
I think it this is just to, you know, Jago is, you know, maybe not the most reliable field agent is what we're learning with this. Is it like Jago is kind of kept at arm's length? Like, he thinks that he's a good field agent because he's got all these connections on the street, but maybe he's been away from the home office a little bit too long. Is what we're starting to find out about Jago, and yeah, so this was Jago's unhinged phase. So we'll see how that goes. But I wanted to be a little Looney Tunes with it. I mean, not that I don't ever want to not be Looney Tunes with it, but he needed to let off some steam. So
was that intended?
Yes, it was.
Mm-hmm. Nicely
done,
sir. That's
the pun there.
I don't get it. I was curious. Like, not that I would... I'm not the kind of guy that switches system mid-adventure. But... cut to the montage of me switching systems mid-adventure. There is an espionage PBTA that has been put out there. I may have mentioned it when I was talking about all the 55 systems. I actually think this is doing enough that it's fine.
No, this is great.
But yeah, given how we're playing this, could this have been PBTA?
Here's the problem, though. And I think the problem is, and I haven't really played like true PBTA, right? But like, the players are in control of what happens on the roll, right? Like, I feel like there's, and I guess I just don't know how PBTA handles like something like a spy or a mystery game.
Right, that's true.
You know, because like you have to withhold a lot of information, and other than the bullshit, like the shenanigans Patrick and I got up to tonight work in PBTA. But what if we were more, you know, stone face or more serious, or we were unraveling the mystery more and more and did more interrogation? I don't know how well PBTA would work with that.
Yeah, I gotta agree with that. I think the you know, the Austin Powers episodes of this where we go and, you know, blow up water heaters and stuff, like that could be done, but yeah, it's hard to picture how PBTA would handle, you know, us trying to get to the bottom of Albi and Tiana. So
I guess that makes sense.
Yeah, and I would assume a move would be like gather information, which would cover like your interrogations or your tales and stuff like I could see how it would work, but I think it just is the structure of our sessions, which Patrick and I are probably destroying your expectations of what you wanted from a spy game. But You're the one who hand waved parking, so you set the tone.
It's my fault. Yes.
Actually, what set this? You know what set the tone from this right away was the pickpocketing the lighter. From that moment
honestly,
on, we were all downhill.
It was doomed from the start.
Right. Yeah. I don't know. I mean, I would try it, right? But yeah. I love this. Like, I'm really enjoying the system. Yep. I know we didn't use any tonight, but the die roll modifiers, like, that's such a cool concept that you came up with. And I'm not saying that PBTA wouldn't have those concepts, and I'm sure it would work just fine, but, like, I don't have any need to switch because this is working well.
Yeah, really I would never do that. Because, and again, the other one I kept thinking about tonight that I was definitely not going to... I've always been curious. I've said this for many different places. I've always been curious about fate. Part of fate's deal is coming up with aspects and using them in the moment. I don't know if I actually have that right because I've only sort of skimmed the rule books, but at the same time, I feel like can't any system just yes and something? I mean,
yeah.
So anyway, well, I'm glad it sounds like you guys are having some fun with this at least. So that's,
I'm having a fucking blast with this, Art. Okay. Like, don't even. Like, this is... Yeah. Don't be coy. This has been great.
I'm sure C can be trusted and that there's no shenanigans there, but now I really think... Now that I say that, I really don't think he can be trusted. And then I'm just like... Now I'm, like, running circles with myself. Like, Art wouldn't tell a story that would have like a double cross from the top of MI6, but also Art may do that because that's what we wouldn't expect. So now, like, I don't even know anymore. So now I am highly suspicious of our own government.
Let me ask you a question above the table. Patrick, I think with Jago, like you said, this is too upstairs for me. I'm a street level, right. I'm an outside cat. You probably on some level, like George C. whatever. You know, they're the boys upstairs. I don't get in their way. They don't get it. Whatever it is.
I don't want the boss to look at me. Like, just leave me alone and let me do my thing. Like,
bam.
Yeah.
But with Veronica above the table, maybe, you know, she had that moment like, what's going on? But what about George? The way you...
I don't know. That, I mean, she's got a lot of... There's a lot of questions she doesn't know the answer to. Remember... The mention of Finland is bringing back all kinds of baggage for her.
Mm-hmm.
And then to now disrupt. So you drag up Finland into back in Veronica's life. And Veronica has had her eyes on being one of the upstairs boys for a long time and not just one of the girl, like a secretary or receptionist or anything. She wants to be one of the heads of MI6. But that was weird to her. That was really weird. And she also doesn't know how she feels about George. She thinks... I don't know.
All right.
And he hasn't been the same, like you said, right? And so she knows that. The last year has been rough for George.
Right. All right. So I guess just as like a...
I'm going to kill them both next episode, just to be sure. There's only one way.
There's got to be a water heater at MI6.
Or you just GoldenEye Famke Janssen it.
I'm going to fucking call them and be like, meet me in the basement. And then I'm just, when they come in, I'm going to ambush them and handcuff them to the hot water heater and do the whole spiel, the whole shtick all over again. Like, you have 2 minutes before this hot water heater blows.
MI6 is being demolished. You have 2 minutes.
So quick temperature check. Does this feel like a Cold War spy game, even though it gets zany?
Of course.
Yeah. Well, I mean, there's the Russian asset.
Checking in all of boxes.
All of us are smoking. Like,
yeah, right, exactly.
Mission accomplished. All right. Well,
no,
very
you're
nice.
Doing a great job.
Basically, I'm just, yeah.
I'm so sorry that we killed your baby.
No. As long as everybody's having fun, that's what counts. Oh, God. I just had one game I wanted to... No.
John Le Carre is rolling in his grave, and Art every night goes to bed and just says, I'm so sorry.
I can't believe I have to go back to this. For those
guys, we should really play Eat the Reich. No, we want to play Spies. No, we should really...
I mean, we should
really...
Oh, God damn, we should really... For those who care, if you want to know all about George Murray's adventures with the Berlin Wall. Go pick up John Le Carré's The Spy Who Came In From the Cold. There you go.
But that's not the one that you're... That's not the scenario we're playing, right?
No, this one is really loosely based on the Looking Glass War.
Hmm.
The Looking Glass War. That really sounds like something where the top brass would be
definitely
little.
The Looking Glass War might have been the book that he wrote after The Spy Who Came In From the Cold.
Mm, look at that.
And it was a commercial bomb. The critics hated it. And John Le Carré, I think, said in the foreword to Looking Glass War, he's like, yeah, this wasn't the book that people wanted me to write after Spy Who Came From the Cold blew up. This wasn't what, because it's very much like a spies are buffoons. You know, it's very critical, almost satire of spies. And everybody's like, oh, we like the other one where it was just a real downer, not, you know,
We're doing the satire part, so really, yeah, there's plenty of, we're paying homage to
right. We're to living up to the exactly.
You're welcome, Art.
You're welcome, John Le Carré. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So, anyway, I've been having a lot of fun. I'm glad you guys are enjoying it. We'll obviously get back to more of this. We should really play Eat the Reich. No. but yeah, as also Eat the Reich. We're going to start stampeding into spooky season at some point. Matt's going to be on the clock at some point. And yeah, we'll go from there. But otherwise, this has been Black Lodge Trivia Night. If you are watching this, you found our YouTube channel, and we appreciate it. If you want to like and subscribe, we'd very much appreciate that, because it's all about winning. And if you prefer audio versions of what your actual plays, just search for Black Lodge Trivia Night wherever you get your podcasts. We should show up. If you want to come chat RPGs, computer role-playing games, solo RPGs, whatever you want, jump into our Discord. There will be a link in the show notes. Otherwise, yeah, we will be back hopefully next week with whatever it is we decide to jump into. So I appreciate you guys jumping into this, and I will talk to you guys soon, and I'll talk to everybody out there soon.
Thanks, Art.
Thanks, buddies.
The music during the RPG session in Foundry was provided by the Foundry module Tabletop RPG Music and composed by Ian Fisher. You can find his Patreon at www.patreon.com/tabletoprpgmusic, all one word.